Hello and welcome by EA's Art Channel. My name is Elkian Wiersma and today I'd like to share with you guys how I painted this born owl. But before I do that, I wanted to talk about a little bit about the canvas. This was a test for me for the canvas. I like to very smooth canvases and I came across this canvas in a store. So I didn't bought it online and actually I cannot find it online, strangely. So that's not very easy for me because I now have to go to that store every time. The store is not that far away, but I like to share with you guys also what I buy and what I like. So I will probably end up buying other canvases again. And the canvas that I used for years is still good, but I once in a while like to try new canvases, new art materials. And this time I bought a few new canvases to try. And therefore I started this little project, and to be honest I like the size of this canvas. It can be a little bit harder to find a nice picture that will suit this canvas. Normally I have more, it's easier because I paint a bit larger canvases and I don't have this horizontal shape. But like I said, I like it. And also I like to mention that I airbrushed the background. And to be honest, you will see when I start the tutorial that I start out with acrylic paint because I want to test a lot of things on this canvas. So I know which techniques I can use on this canvas because I like to use all the techniques, of course, that I normally use. So therefore, I start out with a acrylic painted background and I completely covered it with the airbrush because I want this look. Right away, but like I said, I just wanted to practice some techniques. So I will discuss that more later on in when I actually start the tutorial. And also this born owl is painted with acrylic paints. And I really like that. I like that out of focus look from the airbrush and paint in my details and paint in the colors and the feathers, shapes of the feathers in with acrylic paints. And to be honest, I try to be photorealistic, but I don't do hyperrealism. So therefore I like to show a few brush strokes within my paintings. I think that is something extra for me. I like those brush strokes, but they have to make sense. And I hope you will get dizzy now, but it will zoom in a little bit so you can see what I'm talking about. And here we go. You see here around this beak, you see those lines and you see some obvious brush strokes. And like I said, I like that this in this case they are indicating feathers and shapes of feathers. But if you really look closely, I don't paint very much single feathers. They are clumps of feathers together, and that's what I try to cover there. And then glaze over them and paint them back in and glaze over them. And that's how I build up. So I'm now gonna zoom out again, so don't get dizzy. You see it around the eyes and all that sort of stuff. So I really like to have some brush strokes in my painting. And also on his back there's a lot of texture going on. And as you can see, you don't see any one single feather. It could be happening in some cases, for example, that one feather would stick out a bit more. So I would paint in that case one feather. But in this case I don't. I'd give the indication of feathers, but they are clumps of feathers and they are overlapping each other. They have different colors. There are these spots which I really like. He has in his feather this pattern, I could say, and so I try to cover that as closely as I can, and that will give you in the end, if all falls comes together and is in the right place, will give you a photorealistic painting. So that said and done, before I start the tutorial, I would like to introduce the bird who inspired me to paint this painting. So I do a little clip of the bird that we had in a bird hospital, in a bird shelter, and it was a born owl, obviously, and me and my colleagues, we fed them until he was big enough to be released in nature again. So I will show you a little clip, I thought it would be fun, and then I will start the actual tutorial. So, and this is my little inspiration for this painting. And this is how they look, the young barn owls. And here we are feeding him. And he apparently likes it. And he was here for a few weeks. And then it was time to release him, give him back to Mother Nature. And here he goes.
and he's flying very, very well, and we were very happy to see this. It's a beautiful moment when you can release them back into the wild. And I hope everything goes well for this beautiful born owl. So now back to the painting. I start out with, like I said in the intro, with acrylic paints. Although you see me holding here the airbrush. That's because I have the airbrush filled with water. And I'm spraying that over the paint. So therefore I keep the paint, wet. And long enough to blend it nice and easily with my mop brush. So, and I have, like I said, when I put the water on top of the paint, I can really take all the time that I need to put everything in place. And I'm just now basically putting some sort of on the layers for clouds would it be quite suitable. But like I said, it was just a test for me what this canvas could do for me, because I needed a lot of water. Some canvases cannot take that amount of water. This one had no problem with it at all. And also I want to test the glazes. First I started with water. I just grabbed some green paint and then a little bit of water and just trying it on the canvas. And I was watching for if the canvas would let go of the paint, the under layers, if they would come off when I started layering this thin layer and quite a lot of water back to the canvas again, but it didn't happen. So therefore I was very pleased with it. And also I will use some glazing medium. I'm not using that much of quite often, but for some areas I like the glazing medium. And I think I have it here in, but I'm not completely sure, because it's not very visible when I'm filming it, when I'm making this tutorial, which technique I'm using. Sometimes it's, like I said, water, sometimes it is a glazing medium. And I'm just building up and building up. I'm trying the hairdryer, also a test. How does the canvas react with the heat? Can it take it, and all that kind of stuff. And that is very important, at least if you ask me. If you start using different canvases, and especially if you are selling your artwork, you need to know what will happen as much as you can. Even though it said on the label that it was a professional canvas, I can feel it. The canvas is a little bit heavier than those cheap ones, but still I would like to practice my techniques and see how the canvas reacts to those techniques, and especially the water. There are a lot of canvases that will let go of the paint again when you're coming back with paint with a lot of water mixed in with it. If that happens, you know it is a bad canvas, or your underlayer wasn't dry enough yet. So you have two options. If it happened to you and they claim it's a good canvas, maybe your paint wasn't dry enough yet. Make sure if it that it's dry enough, and then test it. And if it happens again, you are then know that it's a problem of the canvas. But I need to say, obviously, the paint has some influence as well. I'm talking about the Liquitec Basic paints. This is the paint that I like to use. So, and I know that it's a good paint. It does everything I want, everything I need. And also this techniques with the glazing medium and the water. It holds very, very well. So now I started grabbing my airbrush again and fill it now, this time up with paint. And like I said in the intro, I ended up painting all over this first layers because I didn't like it. And here I'm just filling in the first basic layer of the owl. I drawn out my outer line, and then I'm filling it up with gray so I have a nice even on the ground to work from. So I have to draw in my owl again back later, but this is a technique that I saw on Lockery Fine Art, and it works really, really well. I have to say it's a beautiful technique to keep your canvas clean and have a nice basic layer, or basic on the ground to work from. And also I saw by blocking in that gray that I needed a little bit more extra punch in that background. It was a little bit lighter than I had painted it in, so therefore I'm coming back with the airbrush and adjust that. You can adjust it when you basically have finished everything. So if I had painted the owl already, but it's a bit harder because it's very easy to paint over a little bit of the airbrush paint over your owl, and that cannot give the results that you like, of course. So therefore be a bit careful. And that is also why I try to work at the background as much as I can. Now I'm just filling up, I'm just watching my different shapes that I'm seeing. And also I'm working on the underlayers. So I'm not focused on those details completely, but I try to get as close as I can in those first layers of this first layer. And trust me, if you work the same way that I do, you get not very close in this first stage, but it will come later on, and I'm not trying to rush it. I'm taking my time, just building up and building up and building up, and that works for me very, very well. If my first layer or some sections would end up being pretty nice, I just leave them, of course. I'm not going to paint over them because I think, oh my gosh, this is the first layer. Normally I paint over 10, 15 or 20 layers. No, if it looks good, I just let it be there. And now I'm basically using the same technique that I would use when I'm painting fur. And I will have a link pop up. You can see how I paint fur. I have a slower version, a tutorial about that. But yeah, this is the same technique because those feathers did look a little bit hairy in a certain way. So therefore I just used the same technique and made the texture underneath it with some unbleached titanium white. And then I just glazed over it. I have to say, it looks like titanium white, but it isn't. It looks like titanium white because I have no clear white in the painting yet. And to be honest, I only think I have a highlight on his beak that is pure white and a few spots in the eyes. The rest is not titanium white. I have mixed in some colors with that, or I just used the unbleached titanium white straight out of the bottle. So, and I'm just, like I said, building up, I am putting in some highlights. I have to say, most of the times when I'm layering over these highlights, they don't show up anymore, or not as bright, but that's okay. I just need texture now. I can hype up those contrasts, those thin lines, for example, or those sections, those areas I'm just painting in now, back in again. I'm sorry, I hope that makes sense. But yeah, I'm just like always building up. So I'm putting in details, grabbing some color, and go back to the details, grabbing some color. That is basically what I'm doing. Sometimes I'm doing a few layers of different colors, but yeah, that's basically the technique that I'm using. And I'm really, really watching my reference photo. I keep saying that, I know it, but it's so, so important because the direction of these feathers are so important to get the indication of the shape of his head. So therefore I need to be quite close at the direction they are going in, and also the length of the feathers. Because, for example, on just above his beak, those feathers are a bit shorter. Those are teeny tiny lines, though need to be short. Those aren't very long. If I painted them in very long, I think I would end up with an owl who did look to have whiskers. So therefore I need to pay attention, and I know that's it may sound quite obviously, but I made that mistake quite often in the beginning when I started to paint, that I didn't watch the length of fur and feathers as close as I should. So therefore I keep mentioning it. And these are the first layers on the upper hand, and I'm now making that was for Instagram. I'm sorry, that was my phone and then me making a picture for Instagram, and I think I posted on a few of my Facebook pages. But I am just building up those feathers as well, and I really watch the shape of the feathers. I'm not copying exactly the amount of feathers, I'm not counting the amount of feathers, but I'm copying the shape. I'm giving the indication of a lot of feathers there, And therefore the shape is very important. And again, the direction also, because his head is quite round on top. So I need to follow that direction. And once again, I'm slowly building up. I'm taking my time, even though tutorials are sped up quite much, obviously. Not only mine, but basically every art tutorial here on YouTube. Keep in mind, it's sped up. It takes way more time than you see here in these tutorials, obviously, because otherwise it would be endless. But yeah. And to be honest, this is actually a bit quicker painting for me. That has basically to do with the size of the painting. It's not a big painting, so therefore it feels that I did finish this quicker, but that's kind of logical, because the bigger the canvas, the bigger subjects to paint will be there most of the times, obviously. And at this point, I have some texture, a little bit of highlights there in his neck, those feathers. And I think I mixed in a little bit of titanium white with the unbleached titanium white. So it's just, again, not straight white, but a diluted version of white. But I would let it stand out a bit more. So if I glaze over it, as I just did, you will still see that texture. And I will come back at the texture again, hype up some different shapes I'm seeing, some clusters of feathers, and that's how I'm slowly building up the feel of a lot of feathers on this bird. And I really love this gray color. I mixed in just Mars black and titanium white, and I added in a bit of blue and also a bit of purple. And I ended up with a very, very nice color, that purplish gray color. And you can also see some blue in it. But yeah, if you ask me, that's a beautiful color, and it was very well suited for this painting. Because those back feathers and his wing feathers are more gray bluish. And I didn't see this particular color in my picture, but I want to hype up the contrast most often. When I'm painting, I just like it to let it stand out a bit more. I'm just making a painting and not a picture, so therefore I like to use some different colors, and I try to find the colors that are suited for the painting. Obviously, that sounds very easy, but to be honest, it can be quite hard. But I would suggest just try some things, maybe on a different canvas if you are not confident in which colors to use. But it will make the painting way more interesting to watch later on when it's finished, if you have those colors in there. So therefore, nowadays I really try to find some colors who are not in the picture, but I will anyhow include them in my artwork. And I will have quite a nice example for that coming up. I'm working on a pastel painting at this moment. So, in this painting, I also use some different colors. And to be honest, a color that I probably almost never used before. It's a color that didn't suit my artwork before, I thought. But yeah, it's a very nice color that I used for giving a extra. Yeah, a extra interest to my painting, I should say, and I could say, and so therefore, but I will share it, obviously. And for this particular painting, it was a lot of purple and blues. And also a little bit of red oxide for the yellow orange feathers. You see it in his neck, that where the orange feather start, I used a little bit of that red oxide. I will glaze over it, but it stands out very, very well. It's a very strong paint, very pigmented paint, so it's very opaque. But it for an underlayer, sometimes it can be very useful, because it, like I said, it gives that other paint, the other layers, just that extra punch, which sometimes can be very beautiful, if you ask me. And I'm slowly building up, as you can see. I use some yellow tones and some orange tones. that, like I said, work very well with that gray, with the gray feathers. And he had some yellow parts in those feathers as well. I'm just blocking in those feathers. I will get to them later on, but first I'd like to finish. I did finish as much as I could on the on his head. And now, this may be quite interesting because I'm now using, once again, not titanium white for the glazes. I'm using my mixing white. There is a color that is called, transparent mixing white with the Liquitex Basics. It's a beautiful color. It's very translucent, so it's very handy for glazes. And what I did was give it a little hint of purple and blue, same color that I used for the back, but obviously it shows up very way lighter than in the back, but it gives that extra hint, that feel of glow in those lighter feathers. It works really, really great if you ask me. It's hard to see. I think you can see it now because we are very close into the painting. Maybe you can see it now, but I could understand that it's hard to see, but it is there, and it makes those lighter feathers pop way more. So it's I really suggest try that sometimes if you not have it tried it before. I'm sorry, but it's beautiful transparent mixing white. Now I have a hog hair bristle brush, I think you call them. Probably my most cheapest brush I have. Those bristles are very, very stiff, but it works really, really great for those details. There were a lot of different lines in the this owl, so therefore I needed some brush that would hold the shape very well, even when it was wet. And these brushes do that. They will behold their shape very well, so you will be able to put in that rougher texture. And then, as you can see, I'm glazing over it again, and then I'm coming back with the same brush, and I'm building up the texture again and again and again. But I have to say that that is what I do, obviously, but as you can see, I changed the colors of the paint. I didn't mention that, but I changed the colors. I use darker colors, lighter colors. Just depends on which area I am painting in and what basically is needed. So now I'm put it in a little bit high of lighter colors to give a little bit more dimension, I think, to the painting. So I had those darker underlayers there, then came through with the lighter color, and now it's a bit easier for me to glaze in those shadow parts, which makes stand out the upper feathers more, which will you see be happening later on in this painting. I'm just slowly building up. And now I have that same color again, what I just described, that purplish blue grayish color, but I added just a little bit more black. So it's a bit darker, and I use that for Mars black because it's not transparent but opaque, so it will show up better. And now it's kind of starting to look a bit better, but before that, in those first stages, it just didn't look right. It just did look like a mess, and to be honest, I always have to say to myself that this is the stage I have to go through and to make it better. But yeah, it's hard to watch if you're painting. Those ugly stages are so can be so hard. For me, it can be quite rough, but I know I need to paint through those layers. And what is very important, if you find yourself in a similar situation, is to ask what does your painting need? What do you need to include? If you don't have the answer, do something different, let it rest, and come back to your painting or drawing again and watch it again and ask yourself questions. What does my painting need? What do I like? What I don't like? What is can be a way to fix it? And probably you think of layer of a color, so you want to glaze over it again, try to imagine what that color will do to the underpainting you already have on your canvas. And yes, you will get better at it. Maybe it's hard, and this time you think, I have no idea, I don't know what I have to do now. Do I need blue? Do I need purple? Sometimes just try it. The only thing that can happen that it isn't, that it still doesn't look like you wanted to, but you now know that that wasn't the right color and you just need to paint over it again. And if it really, really would go wrong, you just lost your underlayers and you have to paint in them again. And that's basically it. And you have to do it because otherwise you will not get better. It's that easy. And I always get somewhere that I like, and somewhere nowadays it's way easier for me to judge what I need, but because I paint and draw quite a lot. But if I don't know it, I just try the things. I need to finish the painting eventually, so therefore I need to try things. And like I said in the intro as well, those spots on those feathers, those are so beautiful. Once again, the same color, the dark purplish blue color, and just made a highlight of that same color again. So therefore, I didn't have to glaze over all of them because the colors were quite suited for this painting, and I had some paint left of the back feathers on my palette. So therefore, it was quite easy to mix this color for me. And what I do in this stage is just, the painting is basically finished. I'm just hyping up some contrast, coming back, adding some texture back in, or some highlights. Sometimes I'm darkening up some areas. But I like this stage. This stage is fantastic. You can, just a few lines can make a whole difference, even though you may not notice this very strongly as you started painting. And those little teeny tiny details, those lights and darks, those little textures can make a whole, can get a painting to basically to a little higher level, if you ask me. Just take your time and watch your painting, and it helps. It definitely helps. Now I'm putting in a little bit of green, because I use green in the background as well. So therefore I would include it on the owl also, to make it feel like one a part of the whole painting. And you can do that quite easily, to use some background colors and put them on your main subject. Not much, just a little bit. Once again, if you don't know where to stop, or just try it, and if it goes wrong, you have to paint over it. It's just that easy. Don't be afraid of your paintings or drawings. Just try and learn. That's very, very important, I think. Some contrast done on the eyes. A little bit of layering over those teeny tiny lines, so they don't have the same color all over, but a little bit of variation in lights and darks. And I think it makes the eyes pop just that little bit more, that I like so much. Dabbing a little bit with my finger on those lines, so they are not as strong as I'm painting them in. And like I said, I just used a little bit of pure titanium white for the beak, just a little bit. But you can hardly see it, because it's just a teeny tiny bit. And if you use titanium white and you dab with your finger in it, like I did on the shine area on the beak, it is just not as strong anymore. It's still the titanium white. I don't have mixed color within it, but it's just not that strong. And most of the times I like that. I don't want to overdo it, but just that hint of a light there. Some textures back in, some teeny tiny lines, which I like to do. It gives the feeling of way more detail in your paintings. Basically, it's not even that much, because I have all those underlayers in there and all those different colors. It feels like a lot of texture there. But obviously not all painted in with a liner brush. Could be done, I think, but it's not my hobby to take more time than needed for my paintings. And there was that highlight on the beak again. Just hyping it up. A little teeny tiny lines over that background. Makes it more a little bit more interesting. And in the end, it probably goes very fast. I think I have it in. I did grab my airbrush again. And just that white line in the front of the owl. and right next to the owl, I just put it over the owl to make it a little bit more interesting. You see it here underneath his neck. It's a little bit lighter there, just to give it a bit of more interesting. It's more interesting to watch, I think. But this is the picture of the actual painting. I need to say the texture of my canvas is showing a little bit more in this picture than it does in real life. I'm sorry for that. I don't know what happened. I will make another picture, but this one is very, very close, and especially on the colors. It's a very bright painting, and I really love it. It's one of my favorites.
So please let me know what you think of this painting, and as usual, if you have any questions or suggestions, please leave them in the comment section below this video. And for now, I would like to thank you for watching, and if you don't already have subscribed to my channel, please subscribe to my channel. I would really like that. And of course, if you like, please give this tutorial a thumbs up. And like I said, thank you for watching, and I hope to see you at one of my next tutorials. Bye bye.